Conversation with the Candidate continues right now.
Welcome back to Conversation with the Candidate with the 2nd Congressional District Democratic nominee, Maggie Goodlander. Thanks for being here again, Ms. Goodlander.
Thank you, Adam.
So we're going to have questions now from our town hall audience. I might jump in with a follow-up or two, and we have viewer questions coming in from online and on the air. So we'll mix it all in, but we want to start things off with a question from Thalia Flores.
Thank you. Welcome, Maggie.
Thank you.
Thank you for taking my question. Most people have a negative opinion of Congress. How has your experience in Washington, D.C. prepared you to represent your constituents and be part of the solution and break through the dysfunction?
Well, Thalia, thank you for that question, and thank you all for being here. Thank you, WMUR, for hosting us this morning. You know, no one does democracy better than we do in New Hampshire, and growing up here, you learn how to grill a candidate before you learn how to grill a hot dog. And this is a good thing because this is an interview for a really hard job in an unprecedented moment. And part of what makes it unprecedented is the trust in our institutions, our public institutions, including the United States Congress, is at an all-time low. This is true across the board. You know, you take a look at the United States Supreme Court, used to be one of the most trusted and respected institutions in American public life. Mm-hmm. Today, it's lost that trust. To me, you know, Congress, I teach constitutional law at UNH and at Dartmouth, and I'm pretty old school when it comes to the Constitution. The first institution that our Constitution creates was the People's House, the House of Representatives. And at the time, it was the most democratic institution the world had ever known. The idea that you would have a representative voted, elected by the voters, sent to Congress to do the people's work was unprecedented. But this deeply rooted American idea is still one that I believe in because I've seen it work. I've seen how we can get things done when Republicans and Democrats come together, and when you have a small group, it doesn't even need to be a big group. And I think there's enough of a critical mass in Congress, a small group of workhorses, and that's what I am. I'm a workhorse. I'm going to roll up my sleeves, and I'm going to hit the ground running, and I'm going to deliver for this district. I wouldn't be in this race if I didn't believe that right out of the gate I could deliver for the 2nd District.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next question comes from Kevin Donahue.
Ms. Goodlander, Kevin. How are you?
Good morning, Kevin.
Do you have an interest in extending the life of Social Security program? And if so, have you considered a route to get to that
test? Well, thank you for this question. You know, I've thought about this deeply everywhere I've gone in this district. For a small state, you know, it's a big district, more than 6,500 square miles, all the way from my hometown, Nashua, up to the North Country. And everywhere I've gone, this is a concern that I've heard from voters, young and old. In fact, I was grilled on Social Security not too long ago in the Upper Valley by a 23-year-old. And it just shows you here in New Hampshire how focused we are on the issues that matter most. So I believe deeply that we have got to do everything we can to protect and strengthen Social Security. This is one of the ways in which my opponent in this race and I come to the table with very different views of visions for Social Security here at New Hampshire and across the country. You know, to me, the answers, this is a problem we've got to study deeply, but the answer, unlike most questions of public policy, this is a question that has actually a clear answer. And to me, the answer is that the wealthy have got to pay their fair share so that we can ensure the solvency of Social Security. At the same time, we've got to protect Social Security against challenges to its constitutionality. And this is something that we've seen from the Supreme Court time and time again. You know, suggestions in law review articles quickly can become law. And this is something that I will fight with everything I've got for.
Thank you very much.
So thank you.
Next question comes from Chris Stawas.
Good morning.
Hi, Chris. What
would your strategy be to secure federal funding for continuing the fight of the opioid epidemic in New Hampshire? And what's your opinion on the border security on the southern border?
Yeah, thank you, Kevin, for that question. You know, synthetic opioids are the number one killer of Americans between the ages of 18 and 45. Mm-hmm. And I'm encouraged to see that opioid-related deaths have been reduced in Nashua and in Manchester and in other parts of New Hampshire. But this is still the number one killer of Americans between the ages of 18 and 45. The job I left to come and run for this seat was at the White House, leading the president's unity agenda. And the first pillar of that agenda was tackling the opioid epidemic. And we thought about it from every angle. You know, federal funding is critical to delivering the kind of life-saving medication and treatment that we need to address the root causes of addiction here in New Hampshire. But at the same time, we really need to step up the fight against transnational cartels who are delivering deadly drugs, oftentimes across official ports of entry. And this goes to your question about border security. You know, there is a piece of legislation that the president is prepared to sign into law that would have brought about critical updates to our border security technology that would allow us to detect those deadly drugs that are flowing through official ports of entry. This was a bipartisan immigration and border security bill, a lot like the bill that I was really proud to work on 11 years ago when I worked in the United States Senate for Senator John McCain. But you know, this bill was not signed into law because President Donald Trump, former President Donald Trump, decided it wasn't in his personal political interest to see that happen. We need to bring about these changes to update the technology that's going to save lives right here in New Hampshire. And we've got to crack down on the transnational cartels at the border. We've also got to crack down on Chinese chemical companies, because far too often, overdose deaths here in New Hampshire begin with chemical companies in Beijing. And that's not right, and Congress should do something about it. And I want to hit the ground running on day one on this issue.
Thank you.
Quick follow-up for you, Ms. Goodlander. With all the attention put on the northern border in New Hampshire, the state has had to increase law enforcement presence there. In Congress, will we be fighting to bring back a stronger federal presence on New Hampshire's side of the northern border?
You know, I think that federal resources are critical at the northern border as well. As I understand the situation, and you know, as we were talking about earlier, when real-time information about the threats is going to be critical, and having that kind of perspective is going to require federal resources. So yes, I would support fully having all the resources that the state of New Hampshire needs to address border security issues.
Okay, viewer question coming in now. What will you do to make housing in New Hampshire more affordable? Simply building more housing in southern New Hampshire will not address the problem of lack of affordable housing in the area.
You know, housing is an issue I hear about everywhere I go across this district, whether I'm in Nashua or in the North Country. We're in the midst of a crisis of affordability for housing here in New Hampshire. And part of the solution is to build more housing units. We know we need to build 60,000 additional units by 2030, and that's going to require federal resources and a full-on cooperation between the federal government, state government, and local government. Government, as I've learned in my experience, is a team sport, and that's especially true in the area of housing, where we've got a lot of work to do to make sure that state and local laws are pointing in the direction of ensuring that we're going to be able to build the new homes we need. But at the same time, what we're seeing across the state and our country are pernicious corporate practices that are jacking up costs for people who are trying to rent a home or trying to buy a home. You know, having a home is so core to the American dream. It is the pathway to intergenerational wealth, to building a life of security and dignity in this country. And what we're seeing for people who are trying to rent homes, increasingly corporate landlords are using our own data and algorithms to more efficiently and effectively fix the price of rent. This is wrong, and I was really proud to be a part of a team at the Justice Department when I served in the Antitrust Division, who took a hard look at these practices across the country and have taken action to try to take those on. I believe Congress can do something about this to strengthen our antitrust and consumer protection laws, which are rooted in ideas that are as old as America, the idea that no corporation is above the law. But these laws haven't been updated in a lot of cases in more than a century. So I want to get to work on this right out of the gate. I was proud to help enforce those laws at the Justice Department. I want to be a part of writing laws that are going to ensure a fair deal for every Granite Stater who is trying to rent or buy a home in the United States Congress.
Nancy Keene has her next question.
Hi, I am a retired teacher, so my question goes to the education. What role do you think that the federal government has in education? Our students are falling further and further behind, especially since COVID. The achievement of the public school students is not good. Do you think that the federal government has a role in either funding or rules and regulations that will help our students?
Well, Nancy, thank you for your service. Where were you a teacher?
In Concord, New Hampshire.
Well, thank you for...
Middle school. That says
what,
something.
What grades did you teach?
Eighth grade.
That's a tough year.
Yeah.
I remember that as a tough year. Well, yeah. Thank you for your service because, you know, I learned the most important things I've learned in my life from my first grade teacher at Birch Hill Elementary School in Nashua. Her name was Beverly Carter, and I often wonder if she would have entered the profession today, because right now what we're seeing here in New Hampshire and across the country is a real attack on public education, on our teachers and on our students. You know, I come to this race with a deep belief that the federal government plays an incredibly important role in ensuring critical funding streams that are going to allow, they're the lifeblood of public education, especially all across this district in rural areas and urban areas in Nashua, my hometown. And so I will fight for every federal dollar that New Hampshire needs. Far too often, Congress has not lived up to its obligations to fund, including under IDEA, which I hear about every day on the campaign trail. Districts that have had to lay off teachers and administrators because Congress isn't meeting its obligations. This is something I will fight for. I will fight for transparency. What I'd say is my opponent in this race has embraced the idea that the United States Department of Education should be eliminated. This is one of the core tenets of Project 2025. And this is a continuation of the assault on public education. It is one of many expressions of the extremism that we're seeing increasingly in our politics. And I want to bring a common sense, bipartisan set of solutions that I believe will help address these attacks on public educators and public education in America.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Nancy. Next question from Jeffrey Erickson.
Hi, Maggie. So healthcare is a basic human right. Thanks to the Affordable Care Act, my father was able to get the palliative and the hospice care he would have otherwise been denied due to his dementia. If elected, how would you protect and expand access to healthcare for millions of Americans suffering from incurable illnesses?
Well, thank you for this question. And, you know, the Affordable Care Act was an essential step. It's a bill that, you know, unfortunately is on the chopping block. Donald Trump has said that he would terminate the Affordable Care Act. This is a piece of legislation that, you know, has been through the ringer of the federal courts, and that I will fight with everything I've got to protect and to strengthen. Because I couldn't agree with you more. Healthcare is a human right. And it's one that Congress has a lot of work to do to make sure we're delivering it to hardworking Granite Staters who just aren't getting the care that we need. You know, one thing I'd say is when I was at the Justice Department, I was laser focused on three industries in our economy, housing, agriculture, and healthcare. And our healthcare industry in the United States is one of the most consolidated in the world. We have a small number of monopolists who were previously health insurers, now own more providers all across the country. What we're seeing, the lines have been blurred, and I think Congress is gonna need to take a really hard look at where the industry is and the ways in which it is not meeting the needs of so many Americans, including your family. We've got to fight for this, and this is something I will do everything in my power to fight for, to protect the Affordable Care Act and to strengthen it.
Thank you.
We have another viewer question coming in, this one from Elizabeth Brunette, who asks, how would you solve the child care crisis in the state and in the country? It may not be enough to offer funding to families if there aren't enough qualified teachers for the early education programs due to the low wages they currently earn.
You know, the crisis of care, from child care to elder care, is something I hear about every single day, everywhere I go on the campaign trail. It is a real crisis. You know, one of the pieces of it, not too long ago, we marked 104 years since the 19th Amendment became law and women got the right to vote. We brought together an incredible group of people from across the 2nd District to talk about the continuing challenges of gender equality in this country. And one of the recurring themes was the challenge that working women in New Hampshire are facing, particularly working women are facing families overall, but the burden has been disproportionately on women who have had to make difficult choices about whether to stay in the workforce or to go home and care for their kids and for their parents. This is a choice that we shouldn't have to be making today in America. I'm really encouraged to see in the United States Congress more bipartisan proposals that have been put forward, including in recent days. Senator Michael Bennett of Colorado and Senator Marsha Blackburn of Tennessee have come together to propose a bipartisan solution that would engage small businesses, to give small businesses tax credits to assist young families, hardworking families, in childcare. But this is something we're going to have to get creative with. We're going to have to build a pipeline of care, and this is a pipeline of care that's going to be designed to meet the needs of our kids, to meet the needs of the elderly, and also people with disabilities. This is something I hear about every day, and Congress has got to get to work. We saw some progress in the last 3.5 years, but I think I'm very hopeful that this is a problem that has touched every American, and one that we can get bipartisan support and momentum on in the months ahead.
Our next question comes from Charles Jesse.
Hi, Charles.
Good morning. You know that New Hampshire is a unique state with unique people. I'm sure all states feel that way, but we believe it's true. What's not unique about us is the phenomena of urban blue drift, where the large population centers in the U.S. have become moved blue, while the rural populations have remained red. As if New Hampshire sends you to Congress, how will you represent the broad cross-section of voters, and not simply the what's become more of a one-party rule concept in representation?
Well, thank you for that question. And New Hampshire is the best state in the nation, so that's a settled question. At least I think we all agree on that.
Indeed.
Here's what I think. I mentioned I teach constitutional law, and you know, I believe that our Constitution couldn't be clearer that when you seek an office like this one to serve and represent this district in the People's House, you represent all the people of this district. The ones who voted for you, the ones who didn't vote for you, the ones who can't vote for you because they're not old enough or they're not eligible to vote. You represent everyone. And this core idea, I mentioned earlier, the unity agenda that I was really proud to lead for the Biden-Harris administration at the White House. It was an agenda rooted in the basic idea that we can still come together as Republicans and Democrats, rural, urban, no matter where you come from, there are still big challenges that we all face as Americans. And I mentioned one of the pillars was tackling the opioid epidemic. Another was tackling our mental health crisis, fulfilling our sacred obligation to veterans, holding big tech companies accountable to keep our kids safe online, and ending cancer as we know it. These were the pillars. These were the big challenges that were identified. My hope is to build on these challenges and to expand this agenda, because I believe that there is more that unites us than divides us. And it's going to take cooperation and bipartisanship and dogged determination to really get things done and deliver. But the spirit I'll bring to this work is the spirit of representing everyone in this district.
Thank you.
Okay, our last question comes from Carolyn Morrill, and about a minute for the answer, I would say, is about time for.
Okay, thank you. I hear you talking a lot about being bipartisan. Now, if Trump was to win, could you vote bipartisan for any bill that he's pushing for?
Well, thank you for that question, Carolyn. And the answer is yes. You know, the answer is yes, because the job, we've got multiple branches in our government, and the job of a member of Congress is to deliver for the district. So, you know, I think a lot about something that Senator Ted Kennedy said. He said, you know, when it comes to governing, you got to always try to find the 30%. You might disagree with someone on 70%, but you got to find the 30% and get it done. Now, 30% is a pretty big chunk of the pie these days. But what I will always do, I will never overpromise and underdeliver. What I promise you I can do, you know, my grandfather Sam always said, your word is your bond. And what I can promise you is that I will always find the 30% if it's there, or the 3%, or the 0.3%, wherever it is. If I can find a way to work with someone to advance the interests of this district, to advance our values as Granite Staters and as Americans, I will always work to do that and to get it done.
Thank you.
All right, thank you, Carolyn, and thank you, Ms. Goodlander, for joining us on Conversation with the Candidate. We've hit our time there. It's all the time we have for now. Our Conversation with the Candidate series will continue next week with Ms. Goodlander's opponent, Lily Tong Williams, the Republican nominee in the 2nd District. If you missed any part of this conversation or want to watch it back, you can catch it on WMUR.com. Thanks for watching.
Thank you.